First of all of you have come here, a heartfelt welcome after Tashi Dede. Talking about myself, says Tukuk, I do not feel to be in any particular way learned or qualified in any special way. Particularly among so many whom I have actually studied with, whom I've actually went to school with, so to speak, I do not really feel like being special in any which way. And on the other hand, I could not ask them to not come, could I? However, since it has been the order of our teacher that I have to teach this afternoon, I find myself sitting in front of all of you right now, and frankly speaking, I feel a bit shy about it.
I myself feel very much, says he, like a student, being a student of our two masters, of our two lamas, Rinpoches of Benshin Monastery. I do not particularly feel that the time has come for me, for myself, to actually go out there now and teach and guide the students. Also, where practice is concerned, I cannot say of myself to be any sort of special yogi type or anything of that sort. However, the only thing that I can say of myself is that at least regularly I manage to practice what is called Guru
Yoga.
However that may be, it is commonly known that in our Vajrayana tradition, which is also known as the tradition of the secret mantrayana, the teacher, the Lama, is of the utmost importance. We are supposed to consider the Lama to be no different from the Buddha himself, and therefore, of course, it serves us well to remind ourselves of what the qualities of body, speech, and mind of the Lama are all about. Therefore, occasionally finding myself in the awkward situation of having to address students, having to teach them, it is an opportunity to see even this as nothing other but the blessing of the teacher, the activity of the teacher, which leads me to have to do so. But considering myself, often I think that I'm really among the richest people in this world. Of course, to be rich, to have wealth, can be construed as having worldly wealth, having means of whatever sorts at my disposal. But there's also another type of wealth that one can possibly have, and that is none other but having a relationship with the teacher, having first of all made it to enter the path of the Vajrayana, and on top of that, as is indispensable on this path, to have met a teacher and to have a pure commitment with this teacher, this commitment which is known as Dantsik Samaya. And once one has been lucky enough to actually make that, to actually bring these conditions together, and if on top of this one actually has a completely pure samaya, a completely pure connection with one's teacher, that indeed makes one incredibly wealthy. So in this regard, if I think of myself as a student upon the Vajrayana path, having met my teachers, I feel as if I'm the richest person in the world. Of course, thinking along these lines, I often think of the teacher as Vajradhara or Dorjichang, as he is known in Tibetan. However, since I myself am still very much an ordinary person under the influence of veils and obscurations, I'm unable to see the teacher truly as Vajradhara. Therefore, whenever I think of Vajradhara, who is none other but the teacher, just a person of flesh and blood appears to my eye. However that may be, at least I try to the best of my ability to always keep the Lama in my heart, which means to say, to always remind myself of the blessing, of the kindness of the teacher. Thinking about that, about the situation as such, I must consider myself extremely fortunate indeed, because I have truly met teachers who are endowed with what is known as the three kinds of kindness. Myself, I came to the Benshin Monastery at the age of 18, and when I came there, from the Rinpoches, I received teaching. They gave me shelter, they gave me food and clothing. I received everything I could have possibly needed.
Mm-hmm. Chigwares, Lama Chigwares, Lama Chigwares.
In this way, both Rinpoches have cared for me ever since and have given me everything that I could have possibly needed or could have possibly wished for. However, since I am indeed still very much a rather ordinary person, it is not the fact that I could have implemented all the teachings, all the instructions that I have received from them. Thinking about the great kindness that both Rinpoches have extended to me, I could not even find the words to describe their kindness. In this way, having come here today, sitting here in this gathering, I feel rather much like a person among equals. I feel like sitting among Vajra brothers, rather than someone who is more special or who has any more special qualities. Furthermore, it's probably rather more the case that there are many among you here who, in all likelihood, know much more about the Dharma than I do, have received much more Dharma instructions than I have received, because there are many among you here who have already been actively studying and practicing the Dharma even way before I was born, possibly even way before I was conceived by my mother. So in this way, I feel to be rather more on the ordinary side.
The one thing I can say for sure is that I have so far been extremely lucky in my life. I must have accumulated some merit somewhere or other. Otherwise, it would not have been possible for me to meet such two great lamas, such two great Rinpoches as has been possible for me. And when thinking about these two, or finding myself in their presence, I often think that I'm in the presence of two extremely precious jewels who are even more precious than the most precious wish-fulfilling
jewels.
Thinking about these two great masters, I consider them to be completely inseparable, one and the same, not different from each other at all. They are the ones who have basically opened my eyes. They are the ones who have made me see. In this way, they are like my eyes. If I couldn't see, everything would be just dark. However, I find myself in the opportunity, in the fortunate position to be able to see clearly. I can see left and right, I can see all of you sitting here, and this is due to the fact that I can see, that I am in possession of two working eyes.
It was basically my feeble attempt to explain what these two great masters, these two Rinpoches, mean to me. Continuing in this vein, suffice it to say that I'm very happy with the two eyes that I have. Very well served by these two eyes, and there's no need for any more. Some might think three eyes might be better than two. and others might get along with a single eye, but I'm happy with the two I have. I wouldn't want to have any more, and I certainly don't want to have any less. Of course, it goes without saying that I have the greatest respect for all other teachers as well. That should, of course, be a given. However, thinking about myself, I'm totally satisfied with having met these two masters. And every morning when I wake up, I consider myself so very lucky to have been able to meet these two and receive everything that I have received from them. In this way, again and again, I cannot help but think that I'm an extremely lucky person. Having said all that, now the actually offering some Dharma is upon me. Why? Because it is the word, it is the order of our teacher. So let us now speak a little bit about
Dharma.
Whatever sort of Dharma activity we might immerse ourselves in, be it study of Dharma, reflecting about the Dharma, or putting Dharma into practice in whichever way, doing whatever practice each and every one of you is doing, the most important thing before we set out to do so is to time and again make sure that we're possessed of the proper attitude, the proper motivation. To put it briefly, when talking about motivation or attitude for that matter, needless to say, there are different kinds of motivation or attitude. There is positive attitude, there is positive motivation, but we could also be motivated in a negative way. Needless to say, when setting out to do whatever Dharma we do, we must be possessed of a positive, of a good attitude. Because of previous negative habitual tendencies which we have accumulated in previous lifetimes, committing negativity of whatever sort comes very easily. We do not even need the teacher to tell us how to do that. So it just is a second nature to us. On the other hand, where a positive attitude or motivation is concerned, no matter how often we are taught about, we are told about it by our teachers, we time and again manage to very successfully forget about it. Now, when sitting here, all of us together, possibly considering ourselves to be practitioners of the Vajrayana, considering ourselves to be yogins and yoginis, one thing is for sure, if we stand any chance to continue upon this path in any which way successfully, then we absolutely need the attitude that is known as bodhicitta.
That yin bang bu da ko mun de damin da tapje da kyona zu na je ba ni ma yin de su su da ra ni ni da da ga zu la be ro di ma ngi le ni de s
whether or not we present here are yogins or yoginis depends entirely upon ourselves. As it says in the teachings of mind training, the teachings of Lojong, from among the two types of witness, avail yourselves of the services of the more important one. When, whatever we do, there are always two types of witness to our activities. There are others who see what it is we do, who might possibly judge what it is we do, and then, of course, there are we ourselves. We cannot necessarily fully rely upon the power of witness of others because they could be influenced by all sorts of things. They could even be bribed. But we ourselves will definitely be clearly and unmistakably the witness of what it is that we ourselves do. So basically, it is up to ourselves to judge whether or not our actions are of the right type or not.
Tawa samu, gomba samu, cheba samu, samu duwa. Takum chiyo sunde kawala tubi yoresa na, ani inji chanchubi sen, yoyme na, ni tubi yoresa ta.
In our particular tradition, when we speak of the view, of the meditation, of the action, and all of that, or the conduct for that matter, what does all of that boil down to? It boils down to the fundamental attitude or the fundamental motivation that is known as the enlightened attitude or bodhicitta. That is basically when it comes down to the most important thing.
Just to look at that which is called the view, the profound view. What do we mean with the words profound view or the profound viewpoint?
It certainly is not to lean back and close one's eyes and be oblivious of whatever it is that's going on. Even a pig can close its eyes and fall asleep. There's nothing special in that. As the great 19th century master Jangan Kongtrul defines it, the most profound view is to have developed objectless compassion. Compassion that is free of any particular object or focus for that matter.
Well,
speaking of compassion, of great compassion for that matter, of course that compassion should be all-pervading. It should be all-inclusive. Speaking about compassion, truly great compassion, it should be the sort of compassion that is almost like space. Space includes everything, space pervades everything. And just so should be that compassion of ours.
Ane ngaranzu ki inji ya mando iyo res. Inji sherab don demba chit na sherab mayimba. Kupa. Inji kupa. Kyoranzu kupa don mo da. Inji chimbo. Inji, inji, iyo res. Kupa chit na.
Inji kupa.
Inji. Inji kupa. Inji kupa. Inji kupa. Inji kupa.
Where compassion is concerned, it comes in two kinds, or it is of two kinds. Clearly, we speak of intelligent compassion, or compassion that is based on wisdom and understanding, and we speak of compassion that comes without such quality of intelligence.
Compassion
compassion that comes along with intelligence should be of the type that enables us to include even those who appear to be enemies just as well as those who appear to be our friends. So it would be an all-inclusive intelligent compassion. On the other hand, unintelligent compassion, or idiot compassion for that matter, is compassion that depends upon whatever it is that others, whatever sort of relationship we have with others whom we meet. With, endowed with such compassion, we would by all means be compassionate towards those who are nice to us, who give us presents, who praise us, etc. and so forth. But beware if someone should come along who is unfriendly, who ignores us, or even worse. Such a person, of course, and all such other personages could, of course, not be included in that compassion. That is unintelligent, or for that matter, idiot compassion. Having thus been instructed in all likelihood many times, we can safely assume that at least among ourselves as we're sitting here, we're full of compassionate feeling towards each and everyone who has come here, whether or not we have any particular liking for them or not, or so one would assume. Even if that doesn't work, we could, of course, assume that at least among the circle of our family, our relatives, our loved ones, we are also compassionate with each other. But even if that were not to work, one could and should at least assume that we are compassionate with our partners, our spouses, be they husbands or wives, girlfriends, boyfriends, what have you, or so one would assume. Again, one would assume that we're not of the type who, on the one hand, propagate loving kindness, compassion, all beings have to be established in the awakening of Buddhahood, and all of that, yet on the other hand, not being able to peacefully coexist even with our spouses or our family members, and flaring up into fights and all sorts of conflicts at all times. If that were the case, of course, the whole thing would be just a big joke now, wouldn't it be? We would not only delude ourselves, not only would we fool ourselves, we would also fool the Buddha, we would also cheat our own teachers where our intentions are concerned. Now, when constantly going on about all beings, as we Buddhists are wont to do, of course that means all beings. It does not mean only a couple of beings, or some beings who are to our liking or not, but it means all beings, and that of course includes our Dharma brothers and sisters. It includes the members of our family, it includes our spouses, even our children are included among all beings. And when it comes down to it, all beings are included among beings, even those who are of another type, who are non-human beings. So by all means also those who come along with tails and hoofs and horns or whatever, animals of whatever sort, all of these are included among all beings. This is the very nature of the word being. So not only those whom we are able to see, those whom we are close to, but all beings.
그러니까는
in our Vajrayana tradition, it is said that it is utterly indispensable to have this attitude at heart, to have this attitude of bodhicitta, that we by all means must have it at our disposal, at all means must have given rise to it. Because if we go about the various very profound and also efficient means of the Vajrayana, if we're not endowed with that attitude, things could even go wrong. We might even find ourselves reborn among those whom we're supposed to include among all beings, like those with horns and hoofs and tails, and as a result of having practiced the profound Vajrayana without the attitude of bodhicitta. So therefore, this attitude to include all of these beings, this bodhicitta attitude, is absolutely indispensable. Not only is it simply the case, no doubt about it, that bodhicitta is absolutely necessary, totally indispensable, we're also being told so time and again. Time and again, whenever a teaching session begins, our teachers tell us that first and foremost we have to give rise to the proper attitude, we have to bring about the proper motivation. They don't just say that because it's a nice thing to say, or because they enjoy talking about motivation or any such thing. They do so because there is an underlying reason, a very important reason, and therefore, of course, we would be well advised to give rise to that attitude that we are asked to give rise to so many times. In our own particular tradition, we have a system of teaching that is known as Maha Mudra, or the great presence, great gesture. There are various ways of translating it. And in the ancient tradition, we have a similar system that is called Maha Arti, great perfection, also known under its Tibetan term of Dzogchen. You might then reflect about the actual words and think, yeah, we've heard it all before. Maha Mudra. Maha means large. Mudra means gesture, hand gesture. And think, well, that is the end of that. Well, it isn't. Similarly, with Maha Arti, great perfection, we might muse, what is that possible? Is this something like a large jug of wine or some such thing? Well, of course, it isn't.
Maha Mudra, second day, any nana suge, ah, simji nilu, rawa, gila, to samji mures.
If we wish to understand what the meaning of Maha Mudra is, and what we have to do is to familiarize ourselves with the very nature of our own consciousness, with our very own mind nature for that matter. And in order to do so, first we have to listen to teachings or instructions about these things, and then we have to think about them or to reflect about them.
나중에 네 마음들을 나가서 대해서 점점 미친고 당하지 마음들을 인도 보세요. 다 마음들 세계에 나눠주게 아니 다 라면 나눠줄라 준나 아니 나란 게 라면 게 투다 나란 게 쓴 식도 제 되냐 근데 나눠줘 뒤윤도 되지 라면 나눠줄라 준나 되냐 마음들 세계에 마음들 세계에 미미서 등산 항상이 봐 마음들 라면 속에 배야 남나 필같이 라면 나눠줘 라마 라면 속에 나 다 같이 잘 털래 나니 저거 당기도 와. No.
So when thinking or talking about that which we call Maha Mudra, we might wonder, what actually is this Maha Mudra thing? And then we might look up into the sky and we might open our eyes wide and think, Maha Mudra, that is the practice of Guru Yoga to receive the blessing and inspiration of Lama and to merge his mind stream with your own, and then somehow Mahamudra comes to pass. And we might think, okay, that's that then, got it. Far from it, Mahamudra is much more than that.
The Mahamudra is a very passionate person. I have a very passionate person. Sapa sapa lagi tu, lori la, Apple di laptop, Apple di phone, mampu lagi tu, dia tu fashion cahaya tu es, tengsang. Tengah, mah muntah, tengah nak di lama nampak tu, dia sih jaga tu, so mah muntah lagi tu, so lami lami lagi cengla, nanti ni cahaya cengla, tu kiri, tengah sung lama, tengah sung langsung, tengah tengsang mah muntah di, ini dia la mampu lo, lo.
In this way, after all of this talk about Mahamudra that we have been going on about for years, Mahamudra has become, by all means, a very fashionable thing. And just as there are all sorts of other things out there on the marketplace, so to speak, also Mahamudra has made its appearance. We may, by all means, have heard that Mahamudra, yes, that is, Mahamudra is to recognize mind nature, to understand the very nature of one's consciousness, and that happens when one receives the blessing and inspiration of the teacher, then in some way or other Mahamudra happens, and then we go out there and buy ourselves all sorts of books dealing with the subject of Mahamudra and read about it, and actually believe that we've understood what Mahamudra is all about.
Ini nganazu, lama mereka tentu mahamudra, mampu nyamne cina, ini jebu khatuk gres na, ini nyamba cagres, jebu di nyamba senba madewo cagres, lama mereka, lama di juba cina kaya mereka mahamudra guna, ini tak nyamba cagres.
However that may be, one thing is definitely for sure. Those who go about what they believe to be the practice of Mahamudra solely on the basis of books and, or any other medium that they might have studied for that matter, without having received the blessing and inspiration of an authentic master that stands in the transmission lineage of Mahamudra, all of that dealing with Mahamudra will be to not much avail, will be of not much benefit. They might end up more confused than they've started out, and they might even go utterly mad.
Oh yeah. 당연하게 자제 진보 내일 또 버려 봐라. 아니 라면이 진라 라면이 먹어. 그래봐. 아니 나와 순남기 소망 보고 그랬어. 순남기 소망 사고 그랬어.
If we truly wish to bring about the realization of that which they call Mahamudra, we absolutely need, we just cannot do without the blessing and inspiration of an authentic master who is a master in the uninterrupted transmission lineage of the teachings and practices of Mahamudra. But that in itself is not even sufficient. We also need total devotion to the teacher, total trust in our teacher, and on top of that, we also need a whole lot of merit. And also where our relationship to the teacher, the root teacher, root lama as we call them, is concerned. Also that has become a quirk of fashion nowadays, at least with some people. And accordingly, people go around and meet at Dharma gatherings, and they ask each other, who's your root guru this month? And they might say, oh, this one's unfollowing that one, last one's unfollowed the other one, and there is yet another one I've heard about, I haven't met, I definitely have to go sometime next month to make him my root guru as well. In this way, we are rooted here and there and all over the place, but no real relationship actually ever happens. So this is again where the root teacher, our relationship with the root teacher, our root lama is concerned, certainly not the way to go about things. I forgot to say before, a root lama, a root teacher, any teacher for that matter, is not like something that we buy somewhere in a shopping mall and then throw away after 2 or 3 months because we get bored with it. And accordingly, if we were to go about things in this way, we would eventually find our time to have run out on us. All but unnoticed, all of a sudden impermanence is upon us, closely followed by death. And once death is then eventually upon us, and body and mind separate, and we find ourselves in the intermediate state, commonly known as the Bardo, if we then have not made up our minds once and for all which teacher is our root teacher, then we might get very confused because we, in that intermediate state, then have no idea whether to turn left or right or upside down in order to entrust ourselves to this or that or another teacher of whatever sort. So things could get rather confusing if we are unable to make up our minds. There might by all means then be that crowd of root lamas, and among them we might just get trampled. Similarly, in the other tradition that is known as Mahati or Dzogchen by its Tibetan name, the tradition or the lineage of the great perfection, it is no different. And one of the great masters of the Dzogchen tradition, Kyunjin Jigme Lingpa, has accordingly said, without having accumulated a great deal of positive merit, there is no pointing out of Rigpa, as it's called in that tradition, no pointing out of awareness or mindness. Similarly, the great 19th century master Pajra Rinpoche has said, if not endowed with either refuge or bodhicitta, and attempting to practice the very pinnacle of the nine
fold of the nine yanas, Artha Yoga, which is the practice of nothing other than Dzogchen or Mahamati for that matter, nothing more can come of such attempt at practice than the practice or the attempts of heretics, with which he means to say, as we have heard so many times before, if we have not fully put ourselves under the protection of the sources of protection, the sources of refuge, and if we have not given rise to bodhicitta, the enlightened attitude to practice for the sake of all beings, no matter how much we concern ourselves with the crown jewel of all practices, of all jhanas, such as Artha Yoga, etc., just nothing can come of it.
Ronjom Mahapandita, Ronjom Ronjom Ji Sungrava, Ne Jaju Sen, Injini, Pe Kechimbo Yimba, Dela Dene, Ne Ripa, Ripa Motu Yimba, Kongi, Tatinji Sungures, Ronjom Mahapand, Ronjom Ronjom.
Similarly, the great early Nyingma master, Longchen Rabjamba, that one, yes, agree on which teacher we're talking about, has also said that no understanding of what in this tradition is called Rigpa, mind nature for that matter, can occur without having given rise to the attitude of bodhicitta. So clearly the sort of conduct that we should adopt, the sort of attitude, the sort of activity that we should adopt is that of the bodhisattvas, that of those who have entered into the path that leads to awakening. And that for the most part is the type of conduct, the type of activity that is characterized by these six transcendent virtues, which are also known as the six paramitas, etc. So clearly all of this is very much interconnected. Without having accumulated the proper stock of merit, there's no way how we can successfully receive the pointing out of Rigpa, or awareness for that matter, and hope to understand what that is all about in the first place. We need to train ourselves in these activities, for that matter, the six transcendent virtues, etc., in order to accumulate the stock of merit that is necessary to enable us to eventually progress to such understanding and insight. If we are unable, on the basis of being truly compassionate and kind towards others, to even give the smallest present or to train ourselves even in the smallest kind of generosity, well then we do not accumulate any positive merit. How could we? If we do not accumulate positive merit on the basis of such an attitude towards others, what basis would there be in the first place for our understanding the profound meaning of the pointing out of Rigpa or mind nature for that matter? It just doesn't work. So in this way, all of these various kinds of conduct, the various types of merit that we accumulate on the basis of our conduct, etc., all of this is interconnected and not to be disregarded. Where all that Buddhism that we pretend to be also knowledgeable about is concerned, we just need to remind ourselves of its source. What is the source of Buddhism in this world, of the teachings of Buddhism in this world? It is of course no one other but the Buddha. The Buddha who appeared in this world, who was known as the Prince Siddhartha, who became known as Gautama Buddha, and who is known by all sorts of other names,
who demonstrated the awakening of Buddhahood for the sake of us beings. It is not as if the Buddha would have been born all of a sudden out of the blue, so to speak, into this world as the Buddha. Far from it. Even the one who came to be known as the Buddha in our world, a long, long time ago, in a previous lifetime, ages and eons ago, like we are called upon, first gave rise to the enlightened attitude, to the attitude or the motivation of bodhicitta, to the awakened heart. He at some time or other, a long time ago, decided to do something for the sake and welfare of beings. And then, as we learn from the story of the Buddha, for three incalculable eons, he practiced from through many different lifetimes, accumulating merit on the basis of his acting for the sake and welfare of beings, until he eventually appeared as the one in our world who then demonstrated the awakening of Buddhahood for the sake of all beings, and who then became known as the Buddha in our world. So even he did not just fall from the sky, so to speak, a ready-made Buddha. Even he, just as we are called upon, at some time or other gave rise to this bodhicitta, practiced it, and demonstrated its
fruition.
And then, afterwards, over the centuries, a great number of greatly realized masters appeared both in India as well as in Tibet, who also achieved the full awakening of Buddhahood. You can rest assured, absolutely assured, that not a single one of these recognized or realized mind nature and was forthwith liberated just out of the blue, so to speak. Each and every one of these masters, be they the great Mahasiddhas of India, of ancient India of old, or be they the great masters who appeared in Tibet, each and every one of them at some time or other in the previous life, just as the Buddha before them, gave rise to bodhicitta, worked for the welfare of beings, accumulated merit, and as the culmination of a long process of lifetimes of accumulation of merit and practice for the welfare of beings, they then eventually achieved the realization for which they became famous.
As we can read nowadays in the words of Longchen Rabjam, a collection, particularly in the collection of teachings of his that is known as the Seven Treasures, he put extremely great emphasis on the point of bodhicitta, on the point on the necessity of giving rise to bodhicitta, without which awareness or consciousness, for that matter, the mind nature, cannot be understood. He clearly pointed that out time and again, so as to make absolutely no mistake about it. And if occasionally someone would come along to see Longchenpa and would say, I have recognized Rigpa, I have recognized mind nature without all of these preliminary steps, he would quietly point out to them, this is not a case of having understood consciousness. This is clearly a case of being very unconscious.
Rigpa singe khandere sena kunzamyanam na songyore. Denye rig na sangye rig. Deni mari korwa kyams. Deni rig na sangye res. Deni isegi de rigpa de ngontre na sangye sige ta deran res. Ta de ngontre na ta de simji ilu de rigpa de ngomache da roso. Ta ngana zo korwa kyams simji sige cha res.
When wondering what all of this talk of
consciousness or Rigpa in that particular tradition is all about, we might look for a definition, so to speak. And it has been clearly pointed out in the prayer or the aspiration that is known as the aspiration of Samantabhadra, where we find the words conscious or aware of this. This is the awakening of Buddhahood. Unaware of it, this is to be reborn in the cycle of suffering or the cycle of samsara. So on the basis of whatever it is that we've heard and learned and prepared by way of accumulating merit, etc. and so forth, having become aware of consciousness, of the very nature of consciousness, or mind nature for that matter, the awakening of Buddhahood will come about. Unconscious of these facts and not in the possession of what it takes to become conscious of these facts, we will, just like any other ordinary being, continue to be reborn in samsara.
Rigpa la bhikkhu yannam la nima ta dawa ta dena ene ta rigpa di phaje tha ring dhara wa tene khase a la da de ro agar bu de la ta de ene a mang bu ta ne kha cha gi re sa na rang gi su su nam lu gi a di ma ta che lu gi a mang bu ta de ne kha cha gi re sa na ene a ra cha gi nu ri ke ne a sa gi cha pa ra re
So some might by all means think, if I want to recognize mind nature, I just need to stare out into the sky with wide open eyes for long enough, at the sun or the moon or what have you. And if I do that vigorously enough, the realization of awareness or consciousness will come about eventually. Whereas if one were to look at it dispassionately, one would see that it has actually moved rather far off, somewhere off there in the sky. All of a sudden, consciousness is very far away. And there are others who think, there is one particular practice, which is that of the white the Tibetan syllable that I just have to imagine out there in the sky. And all of a sudden, the sky is full of and many more of these white Nothing whatsoever happens. One eventually becomes of the nature of itself. Which, when it comes down to it, is nothing other but a pile of shit. And particularly in the northern Nepalese region of Nubri, and as we hear also, in Tsum, which is the neighboring region, this is a well-known proverb or idiom.
Chung chung kapsu, mambu gom, namla mambu tarwa, tanda nik desu kyunshur. Nima ha mambu, nima taya de tambu nini, mikshe nambu jinyo na pe yabu yura, ane mikshe jaktene ya, tanda mikla pengirwa. Nima tam mikshe de yomara, mikla ya, namla tanda nita, mikla desu kyunshur.
Not to give the impression that I wish to talk badly about different traditions. It is rather personal, painful personal experience. When I was young, says Togo, I did so myself. I also believed that to practice in this way would make a difference. And I sat there and I stared up into the sky, and all it brought about actually was painful eyes from all the staring into the sky. And I imagined all of these syllables all over the place, and nothing much came of it. It was only much later that I understood about how to properly go about these practices, how to properly train in this way. And particularly nowadays, as we are more educated, certainly one would know that to stare into the sky and into the sunlit sky for a long period of time will just cause you eye trouble. So if you are to attempt this in any which way, at least make sure that you're going to wear some proper shades.
Kandiyeche tabu yinpade, ini ngana tueso, shini hakoso. Nyama hako maso, namla jangya tadiro, ini jangya kyoshoso. Nyama hakoso.
Nowadays, having been fortunate to have met our precious two Rinpoches, I know better. At first, I fully believed that consciousness could be found and recognized by simply staring into the sky or imagining syllables or whatever, and all it got me was painful eyes. First, of course, I had to hear these instructions, and then on the basis of these instructions, I had to put them into practice due to the kindness of our two precious Rinpoches. So whatever has been heard, whatever has been reflected about previously has now become personal experience. At this point, I wish to conclude this afternoon session, but not without stressing one more time how fortunate I consider myself, how fortunate all of us are to have met and to continue to meet our two precious teachers, particularly to be able to come here to listen to the instructions on the union of Mahamudra and Mahaati by the great previous master Kamachagni. What we're able to do with these instructions, if we're able to put them, whether or not we're able to put them into practice eventually, or derive even more benefit of them than just hearing these teachings, that remains to be seen eventually. But one thing is for sure, and that is that in order to just be able to come here, to meet our teachers and to hear such instructions from them, already a great deal of good, a great deal of positive merit, by all means, has been accumulated previously. Otherwise, we would not be here in this fortunate situation. Our precious Rinpoche, that is Tang Rinpoche, of course, in this particular regard, coming here from a long distance to teach the Dharma to us, to transmit these teachings to us, well, he doesn't do that just for the fun of it. He has a great deal of inconvenience himself, physical, etc. And he doesn't come here just because he considers it's his idea of good fun. He comes here because he is driven solely by the greatest of compassion, the greatest kindness for beings. And being endowed with that greatest kindness, loving kindness and compassion for beings, among whom, of course, we ourselves also find ourselves, he comes here to give these teachings. This is something that we should always remember. We should never, ever forget what great kindness is being shown us and what great compassion we find ourselves immersed in when we're in the presence of our teachers. In this regard, we're also fortunate ourselves that it is possible for ourselves to come here at this particular time when our great teachers are able to come here to give us teachings, to receive teachings and instructions from them. This is a great opportunity, and we should always remind ourselves of this opportunity, particularly whenever we have the time, whenever we have a free moment to think about things. We should time and again remind ourselves of the extremely great kindness that is being shown to us here. Just the very fact that we are able, that we've been able to come here to receive instruction from our teachings, is a clear indication that
in previous times we have accumulated at least a certain amount of good merit. Otherwise it would not be possible for us to be here. And nowadays, as in previous times, to be able to meet a teacher and receive instruction from a teacher is an extremely great fortune. In previous times, to travel to see a teacher was a rather tedious affair. It took long and took lots of efforts. Nowadays, things have become rather more easy. This is all because, undoubtedly, we have accumulated great merits in the past, a great accumulation of merit in the past, without which such meetings would just not be possible. This is also something that by all means needs to be considered, needs to be remembered again and again. And if one would be unable to appreciate what a great opportunity we have here, what great kindness is shown us, and what sort of a happy and fortunate situation we find ourselves, if we would have no appreciation for that and just take it as a given, well, then we would surely be beyond any help. At this point, let me apologize for having been rather long-winded. It clearly is an indication how much I myself am still under the influence of habitual unconsciousness. So I've come a long ways, I've finally made it here, and as my teacher has instructed me, I have shared a few words of teaching, a few words of Dhamma with you, so basically my chore is done. Thank you so much.